I'll be speaking on adenokeratoconjunctivitis decoded. I'm a consultant at Sitapur Rai Hospital, Cornea Services. So conjunctivitis has been defined as the inflammation of the conjunctiva and is characterized by cellular infiltration and exudation in addition to vascular dilation. It is a significant cause of morbidity worldwide. So it is characterized by the presence of follicles, which are yellowish white discrete rounded elevations of the conjunctiva. As you can see in the picture, they appear like boiled sago grains, and they are basically a lymphocytic response, as you can see in the picture drawn over here. So they, and the center is avascular, and the vessels are at the side. And this size of the follicle is generally between 0.5 to 2 millimeters. So adenoviruses are typically DNA viruses and the most common cause of viral conjunctivitis. There are 52 distinct serotypes, and more than 50% belong to the subgenus D. So it has, adenovirus infection can be characterized into four types: the pharyngoconjunctival fever, epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, acute non-specific follicular conjunctivitis, and chronic keratoconjunctivitis. So pharyngoconjunctival fever is generally caused by adenoviruses 3, 4, and 7, and is associated with pharyngitis, which can be mild to severe, with follicular conjunctivitis, with fever up to 10 days, and adenopathy in the form of preauricular or cervical lymphadenopathy is mostly seen, as can be associated with diarrhea and rhinitis as well. It has small outbreaks with an acute onset, and it is transmissible by three routes, that is personal contact, fomites, and swimming pools or ponds. It is highly communicable, and it lasts for about 2 weeks after the onset of symptoms. So it is generally a bilateral involvement, whether it can be simultaneous of both eyes or a sequential involvement, and the second eye is less severely involved. And the most common complaint is itching and irritation with a serous discharge. So, and the conjunctival condition is more marked in the inferior fornix. Mild punctate keratitis can be seen, but subepithelial keratitis is not frequent. So, the next variety is the epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, which is the most commonly formed, and it is seen by 8, 19, and 37 variants, and it is the severest form of the ocular disease. It is transmissible by contaminated fingers, objects, including instruments, and therefore a visit to the hospital where instruments, infected instruments have been used, like a tonometer or something, they can be a source of that. 50% have unilateral disease, but mostly then what happens is the other eye also gets involved. Differentiating features from pharyngoconjunctival fever would be the extraocular manifestations and the severe stromal infiltrates. These patients do have a lit edema, and the conjunctiva has a watery discharge. Congestion is there, conjunctival. It can have a mixed follicular or papillary response. As you can see in this picture, it shows follicles. Petechial hemorrhages or subconjunctival hemorrhages are characteristic of epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, and so is the presence of true or pseudo membranes. Now, a true membrane is one which bleeds after on touch or removal, and a pseudo does not. Earlier on, it was just indicated that chlamydia infections and others were indicated for a true membranes. But recent literature and studies have also shown that true membranes are also seen in case of epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, and they have to be removed. The cornea shows basically four phases, where it starts off with the punctate epithelial erosion, which goes on to form superficial punctate keratitis, which forms subepithelial keratitis, and finally these can form scars which are permanent and they don't grow. The most important phase that you want to see is this subepithelial keratitis phase, because if it doesn't grow, it forms the scars, and this can cause photophobia, which is the most common cause for this, and visual problems for this patient, particularly if it is center involving. The one thing to remember it as, these patients have normal corneal sensitivity in comparison to a HSV infection. So the next variety would be a non-specific follicular conjunctivitis. It is a milder involvement, and its identification is important, even though it's mild, because they have a virus reservoir and they can help in spreading the disease. Chronic conjunctivitis is caused by adenovirus 2, 3, 4, and 5. It is least common, and they generally spontaneously resolve. The diagnosis is mainly clinical. Laboratory investigations are there. PCR is confirmatory. However, the main diagnosis is based on clinical features. So clinical features can be made into mild, moderate, and severe categories. The mild forms is generally diffuse congestion or a conjunctival congestion with follicular reaction majority with a plus minus papillary response. Moderate would be a subconjunctival hemorrhage or a petechial hemorrhages along with the presence of membranes. Severe forms would be the SPKs and the subepithelial keratitis or infiltrates phase. So the goals of management in such a case would be symptomatic relief, minimize the spread of infection, shorten the duration of infection, complication management, and also prevent the further the visual function. So the treatment is generally symptomatic relief with artificial tears and cold compresses. Some people do use naphazoline and topical antihistaminics. Oral analgesics are definitely given because there is dead edema, particularly in cases of EKC, and you need to give something like a diclofenac, which helps to relieve that edema and also gives a lot of comfort to that patient. Dark glasses because of photophobia and all the situation, and also preventing the spread of the infection to the others. So therefore, dark glasses are supposed to be given. To minimize the spread of infection, this is very important. You need to counsel the patients and their family members so that they avoid the personal contacts. They wash their hands properly after touching the eyes or putting the drops. And they have to avoid sharing towels, pillows, or any personal item that is contaminated by the ocular secretions. And they should also be told not to rub their eyes. However, any discharge that can be cleaned off with wet wipes or something like that. To shorten the duration of treatment, ganciclovir ointment has been used. However, the results of the studies have been not statistically significant and it is therefore not used in practice. There have been promising results of the use of providine iodine with dexamethasone, but it needs to be further validated. It is not routinely used. Coming to complication management, membrane removal is extremely important because if you don't do it, there will be conjunctival scarring, symglyphon formation, and corneal ulceration can also take place. So it causes a lot of discomfort. So, topical steroids are definitely indicated in such cases to preserve the visual function, particularly in the subepithelial infiltrates or the subepithelial keratitis phase. You need to give steroids. People can start with low frequency steroids, low potent steroids like lotiprednol or fluoromethylone, or you can even give prednisolone or dexamethasone. However, you need to monitor the IOP. People have started using tacrolimus also for this phase or cyclosporin drops. However, I have no further experience. One thing is, if a contact lens user, they must stop using contact lenses and change them also. So the role of steroids is definitely controversial, early symptomatic, because you know it gives early symptomatic relief to the patient. It can worsen the underlying infection, so therefore close follow-up is warranted. Animal model has shown prolonged viral shedding with the use of steroids. However, it is not known in humans. The raised IOP is always a problem, and therefore low potency steroids people are using. In my preference, in my practice, I do use steroids from day one, whether it be SPK, SEK, or whatever phase is there. Definitely indicated in membrane and the SEK phase, but I use in all the cases because particularly if the patient is symptomatic, got chemosis, got lid edema, and you know you need to give that relief and make that patient miserable. So I prefer to give, my combination is amoxidexa combination along with lubricants with diclofenac and an antacid. The role of antibiotics, definitely, doesn't have any role, particularly in viral conjunctivitis, adenoviral conjunctivitis. So coming to my last slide is that, you know, conjunctivitis, adenoviral has to be differentiated from the COVID-19 conjunctivitis, which is because of the pandemic. So one thing that you need to know is the petechial hemorrhages, subconjunctival hemorrhages, the presence of corneal infiltrates, punctate epithelial keratitis, and the membrane formation. These are all typical signs that would be characteristic of adenoviral conjunctivitis rather than COVID conjunctivitis. And if a patient has a COVID history, you can definitely say that would be COVID. So to conclude, symptomatic management needs to be tailored according to the patient's needs. Topical steroids are controversial but provide early relief. There is no role of topical antivirals or antibiotics. The counseling of the patient and family members is important to prevent the spread. And follow-up is important of these patients to look for subepithelial keratitis or infiltrates and vision-threatening problems. Thank you so much.